Welcome to episode number 48 of the Mastering Marriage Podcast, where our goal is to strengthen, unite, and restore your marriage. Everybody, my name is Amanda Taylor, and together with my husband David, we are the co-founders of MendOurMarriage.com, and our goal is to break the back of divorce by bringing married couples together to be accountable, keep the passion alive, and destroy the hidden issues that try to rip marriages apart. And we are back in the booth today with another awesome episode with me, of course, Amanda Taylor, and my husband, my co-host, my boo, David Taylor.
Yo.
Hey, what guys. What up? That's what David would say.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to episode number 48 of the Mastering Marriage Podcast. This is going to be like, when I say juicy, I mean like really juicy, like heavy juicy.
Like strawberries?
Like, no, that's not enough juice. We need a lot more juice. But this is going to be a really information top heavy episode, and it's going to be a three-part series. So today is part one of three parts that we're going to do on the topic of the six stages of marriage. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to kind of jump right in because we got a lot of information and not a lot of time.
All right, let's go.
And so I want to, you know, I will say, you know, the usual, this episode is brought to you on behalf, but we'll get to that at the midpoint of the show. So we'll kind of tell you what's going on, what the new stuff is going on with Mend Our Marriage. But I do want to just say, before I get started, thank you everybody for tuning in.
Yes.
Thank you guys. We really appreciate your consistency when it comes to adding value to your marriage, your dedication to your marriage, your desire to grow. We thank you for that. So just did want to add that in there.
We love y'all.
We love y'all. So without further ado, get a pen and paper or pencil and paper and go ahead and get ready to write some notes because this is going to be juicy. So this is part one of three parts. Okay. And we're going to be talking about the six stages of marriage. And so check this out, right? Having a healthy marriage doesn't happen on accident, right, Mandy?
Not at all. No.
It's like, it's a skill. Like, I want you to think of a healthy marriage as a skill that has to be cultivated with three things: time, education, and experience.
Yes.
But it's a skill, like actual skill, like shooting a free throw is a skill. Having a healthy marriage is a skill. Mm-hmm. It doesn't happen on accident. I seriously believe that because of societal pressures and failed in-home examples like we had, most people get married expecting for their marriage to magically grow and thrive on its own. And guess what? It's not going to happen. Mm-mm. That's like getting a brand new car, right? And you know, like the car you got, mm-hmm. when we got it, they filled the tank up with gas. It was so nice. Filled it up with gas. But it's like, you know, expecting your marriage to magically grow on its own is like getting that new car with a full tank of gas and expecting to never have to put gas in it.
Or like studying for a test or having a test and not studying for it. Yeah. and expecting to pass it.
Exactly. And I don't know about, well, I think I've probably passed a few tests without taking or studying, but you know.
Mediocre average.
Yeah. But just think about that. Remember, your marriage is a plant that only grows when cultivated. So I'm starting to show up. I want you to think about your marriage is a plant that only grows if it's cultivated. If you don't cultivate it, guess what's going to happen?
It's going to die.
Snap, crackle, pop. No, that wasn't the right time for the snap, crackle, pop. Wasn't with death. It was breaking the back. Was I? Yeah. Okay.
You was off.
I was off.
We had the plant analogy going. You got to go with water.
Where did
with
you snap, crackle, pop from?
Breaking the back of divorce.
Okay. Because that's you what was we hype. Have to do.
You was hype.
Did you say that already?
Just no, not yet. You forcing it.
Okay. Anyway, so let me get back on track. Okay, so we missed y'all. I turned up a little bit. But anyway, so let's go. So remember, your marriage is a plant that only grows when it's cultivated. You've heard us talk about this in the past, but this year we're actually going to go deeper and deeper into focusing on educating marriages, because I truly believe that you have to educate your marriage in order for it to grow.
Right.
Right. You've actually heard us say that if you get a driver's license, you have to take a test. When I got licensed as a therapist, I had to take a test. You know, I really believe that in order to get a marriage license, people should start demonstrating or having to demonstrate a certain level of knowledge first. Mm-hmm. I really think that that's the only fair thing to do.
Exactly.
You know, and so, you know, you gotta get, you gotta get tested, demonstrate your knowledge.
Exactly. And this is like really one of the most, if not the most important job you have while on this earth.
Oh my goodness. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm just saying, go on, get tested. Anyway, but so, all right, so check this out. Remember, I said this earlier, having a healthy marriage is a skill that is cultivated with time, education, and experience. It requires all three to survive, not just two, but all three, time, experience, and education. Okay. So today, as with most of our podcasts, we're going to be focusing on the education tier. So if you think of three tiers to a healthy marriage, time, education,
and experience,
we're going to focus on the education part. So I hope you're ready again, because we're going to dive deep. So take some notes. Today, the six stages of marriage and why each stage is important and what to do in each stage. So, all right, check this out. It is our hope that with this information, you could recognize which stage you're in, right? And learn new ways to cultivate your relationship depending on that stage. Also, some of y'all may be confused regarding why your marriage is all of a sudden different, like I know I was. And some of y'all may be reluctant because of these changes. Mm. Hopefully, with this new information, you can understand why you are reluctant and be proactive about moving from that position. Okay? So let's go ahead and get started with the first stage. And in this episode, we're only going to do two stages because this is a lot of information. So episode number one is only two stages. So the first stage is called the love addict stage. Now, I coined it this way for a certain reason. It'll make sense in a minute. But this is, in my opinion, the most dangerous stage of relationships and can have the most detrimental effects on marriage. As a matter of fact, most people get married because of this stage. And then, guess what? They get divorced when this stage disappears. This stage usually lasts about 3 years. Actually, research shows that it lasts about 3 years. And then it starts to go into stage two.
That's amazing.
I know, because if you look at the trajectory of our relationship, it was very similar. We won't get there
yet. And that's supposed to be the honeymoon, greatest stage.
Man, I know. I know. It's so funny. It's so funny. Deception. How that works. So, okay. Did you know that research has shown that the brain chemistry of some people, actually a lot of people, during the in love phase is very similar to that of a drug addict or a compulsive gambler? This is amazing. They hook them up. And they measure the brain frequencies, the brain waves, and see which parts of the brain fire. And they saw that in gamblers and drug addicts, people that are addicted to drugs like cocaine and things like that, it's the same areas of the brain fire as those that are in the in love phase. It's crazy. They say that there's an increase of chemicals such as dopamine and oxytocin. And these are those chemicals that stimulate the pleasure center of the brain. And so those things fire, you know, when you're in the in love period or phase of your relationship, and you really think it's an emotion, but a lot of it is also chemical. Here's another thing, and some people may not like this, but being in love, like that in love feeling, is very similar to having OCD or obsessive compulsive disorder.
That's deep.
It's funny. It's not funny, but it is kind of. And like, because think about it, instead of being obsessively compulsive about a certain behavior, which is what OCD is, you're obsessively compulsive about the other person. And I know I was like this. Maybe you were, Mandy, but I remember, you know, I used to look at your picture all of the time when we first met. And I would like daydream and just kind of relive those moments and, you know, keep the butterflies going. You know,
I remember getting I remember getting so excited when I used to hear his voicemail. I used to call or see him calling, and I still get excited when he calls.
No, this is David. How you doing?
No, you did not sound like that.
But it's funny. It's
but yeah,
it's,
I remember that.
And those things were like triggered in my brain.
It consumes you.
I was very consumed with you. It was like I kind of worshiped the ground that you walked on. You know,
I agree. I was the same way.
You know, I literally believed, and this is the truth, honest to God, I literally believed that Mandy was perfect and that I was extremely fortunate and the luckiest guy on the earth to be in a relationship with her. I used to tell you every time?
Amaze him.
I would say that almost literally every single day.
You amaze me.
I was amazed by, and it was feeding her head, blowing that head up. Big old head. I'm sorry, but it was blowing your head up. But no, I used to say that, and I would mean it. I genuinely meant it. Here's another example as to why this stage of the relationship is so dangerous. And this is one of the traps that we fell in as well. So think about it like this. If you naturally have a low sex drive, right? These in love feelings, the chemicals that are firing in your brain will dramatically and temporarily boost your sex drive so that it appears to be on the same level of your partner, especially if your partner has a higher sex drive than yours, right? Mm-hmm. And it's almost as if you two are extremely sexually compatible at this stage.
That is so interesting. Yeah. I guess I never thought about it like that, because you hear over and over how people think, okay, well, we got married and, you know, it seemed like when we were dating and stuff that we were just on fire for each other. And then you see a change in one person, or you kind of like see changes in each other and mm-hmm. the sexual appetite.
Yep.
And I think that's why it's so dangerous with these movies and these different books and things like that, because people feel like they have to be that.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's crazy because it happened to us.
Yes, it really did.
Mandy presented with a higher sex drive than me in the relationship. But when we first met, right, it was almost like our sex drives were compatible on the same level. Mm-hmm. And so imagine when those chemicals start to fade and that season or that stage of the relationship winds down, right? All of a sudden, my sex drive goes a little lower, Mandy's goes a little higher, and guess what happens? Conflict. Mm-hmm. And this actually leads to the second stage, but we'll talk about that in a minute. But yeah, I mean, if your sex drive is naturally lower, it will appear higher at the beginning of your relationship.
Right.
And so you got to keep those things in mind, because these are the conditions that lead to power struggles and things that affect relationships in the future.
Right. And it's not that somebody means to put on or anything. It's like literally a chemical imbalance. So think about somebody with OCD or these other disorders, different issues going on mm-hmm. that are actual clinical diagnosis. People are on medication for some of these things to regulate their emotions. So think about it. If this in love feeling is comparable to OCD and some of these other, you know, mental conditions mm-hmm. or emotional conditions, then you really think about that. The person doesn't mean for that to happen. You
it
know,
just changes over time.
Yes. And we define that as love.
Yeah.
As pure love.
Yeah. Crazy. It's you know what? Like, think about the Romeo and Juliet play.
Mm-hmm.
Like, most people read it from a westernized 2015-16 lens.
Mm-hmm.
But really, that play is a satire on how they view love.
Right.
And they view love as like a crazy condition.
Right.
It was almost like they discouraged you from falling in love because it made you do crazy things.
Exactly.
It's just amazing how now, though, everybody is after that elusive feeling of love.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll get to that later. But anyway, yeah, so just kind of keep that in mind. In the love addict stage, it's full of the physical attraction and romance, right? In this stage, you are usually more physically and sexually attracted to your spouse than in any other stage.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I won't say any other stage, but any of the first three stages.
Mm-hmm.
So just kind of keep that in mind. Remember this, just because you're attracted to them, that doesn't mean that you're compatible with them. And so some of y'all have to work overtime to make your marriage work now because you mistook sexual attraction for long-term compatibility. Said it again, just because you are attracted to them, that does not mean that you guys are compatible. So you may have to overcome more barriers now to increase the level of compatibility because y'all were just sexually attracted to each other.
And that doesn't mean that you shouldn't be married. It just means that you have to put in more work.
Yeah, exactly. We're going to call it what it is. A spade is a spade.
Yep.
Because y'all fell in love or had that in love feeling, it's going to require more effort now.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what we're here for, right? To provide solutions and to help.
Yes, because we have been there.
We was there. We was exactly there. And we mistook that attraction for compatibility.
And we're not perfect now. We still work through things.
Oh, my gosh, yes. Just the other day, Mandy beat me up because... No, I'm joking. But anyway, here's some other things to remember. Here are a few final thoughts about the first stage. Okay, so the love addict stage is usually accompanied by three hooks. So I want you to kind of think of these three things, and I want you to start to look at yourself and ask yourself, which of these three did I kind of fall victim to? So the three hooks are lust, romance, and attachment.
Ooh.
Yeah. Ooh, it's good.
My goodness.
So think about this. Depending on your past experiences, any one of these can be activated. Thus, greatly influencing the reason for your decision to get in a relationship in the first place. This is deep. Remember, lust, romance, or attachment. For instance, if you have had a past marred with sexually inappropriate experiences like me, it's easier for your lust to be aroused. Mm-hmm. See, I was exposed to porn, and I talk about this in my For Husbands Only podcast. That's for husbands only, so y'all can't listen to it. Y'all women? No, I'm joking. But I was exposed to porn at the tender age of 12, and that ignited an appetite for sexually attractive women, right? A category, if y'all haven't figured out by now, a category that my wife fits very well because she just kind of built right in the right places. But anyway, we're not going to go there.
Thank you, babe.
But I'm just saying, I mean, so I imagine... What'd you say?
I said, thank you, I think.
Yeah, you welcome, baby. Because when I first met her, like, Mandy was banging.
When you first met me?
No, not... No. You banging. But I'm just saying, like, using this analogy...
I'm
like,
just messing.
Lust was aroused extremely when I first met you because you were proportioned in all the right places, mm-hmm. right? And so I still remember that one outfit that... No, we're not going to go there.
My God. What you...
Is that the multicultural?
I know what outfit you're talking
anyway,
about.
Anyway, so let me talk about the romance part. Let's say that you have a longing for a connection and acceptance. You know, the romance hook may be easily activated first, right? If you watch, you know, those movies, those romance
movies. The Notebook,
movies,
Love and Basketball, mm-hmm. 50 Shades of Grey.
You have that desire for that connection, that level of connection, and you are hopeless, romantic.
You know, 50 Shades may be the lust category.
Yeah, 50 Shades may be. Yeah, but think about that. Think about which one of those were activated first with you. Also, here's the last one. If, let's say you grew up with mommy or daddy issues, like me, I had daddy issues, because there were unmet needs that developed at that time in your life. Mm-hmm. Your attachment hook was most likely activated easier. So it could be lust, romance, or attachment, but one of those three, or it could be a combination mm-hmm. of those three, mm-hmm. right? But usually it's a combination of those three that make it easier to get caught up in the love addict stage.
Wow.
Yeah. I want you guys, as we're talking about the first stage, to just kind of evaluate yourself, right? The first part of overcoming and healing anything is to be aware of it, to know that it exists, to know mm-hmm. what's going on inside of you.
Right.
So be aware of the fact that you may have ventured into this second stage because of what's going on, what happened in the first stage. So now that you have the first stage understood, let's wrap up this episode by discussing the second stage of marriage.
Are you experiencing trust issues in your marriage? Is there emotional distance? Are you having a difficult time healing after an affair or struggling with managing conflict with your spouse? The harsh reality is that half of all marriages end in divorce, and of those that stay married, only 30% rate themselves as being happy in their marriage. Maybe taking the traditional approach to healing your marriage is not enough. We would like to invite three couples to come stay with us for 3 days and 2 nights at our Mastering Marriage Intensives. During this experience, you will receive over 15 hours of counseling and coaching from both David and myself. Our intensives are for couples who are on the verge of divorce, couples who are overwhelmed by the stressors that accompany marriage, and for couples who feel like they have run out of options regarding how to heal their broken marriage. If you would like to stay in sunny Orlando, Florida with the Taylors as we help to enhance your marriage, now is your chance. Our first intensive is scheduled for April the 8th through the 10th. Registration is on a first-come, first-served basis, so sign up now. Go to www.mendourmarriage.com/marriage-intensives to learn more.
So the second stage of marriage is called the mirror stage. And in this stage, power struggles are the most prevalent and the most destructive. So if you think about it, there are both doubt and reluctance that start to rear their ugly heads at this stage of the marriage. And we're going to get to that in a minute, but let me kind of share some other important concepts for you to remember. So think about this. As humans, we are wired for both connection and protection.
Right.
So depending on what stage your marriage is in, you will either be more prone to connecting with your spouse or protecting yourself from your spouse. Isn't that something?
It is.
Depending on what stage you're in, right? So usually, if we feel threatened or unsafe, we protect ourselves from being vulnerable. This notion is extremely true in relationships. So here's something that if you don't take anything else from the stage, I want you to remember these next concepts. Men usually have two areas of vulnerability in marriage, and women usually have one. Even with this truth, though, you may find yourself with all three. So just because I say men have two, women have one, that doesn't negate the fact that some women may have two or three, and some men may only have one. But so here's the things, though. So men are the most vulnerable. Get this, guys and ladies and gents. Men are the most vulnerable when they feel criticized and or when they feel incompetent. So men are the most vulnerable when they feel criticized or when they feel incompetent. Mm-hmm. Women, on the other hand, feel the most vulnerable when they don't feel connected with their spouse. Their fear is usually centered on this question: do you still care about me? So in relationships, there are three main ways that both men and women react to conflict or when they feel vulnerable but not safe. And you guys have probably heard these things, but so this is kind of basic psychology, but you'll either be more likely to fight, to freeze, or to flee. Those are the only three ways that people deal with conflict: fight, freeze, or flee. So let me show you how this looks in an actual conflict. So let's say that you go to your husband to discuss how he continues to spend money each month without speaking to you first, right? So he has some money mismanagement problems. Let's say that in the course of this heated fellowship, because that's what they call them, right?
Yes.
They heated fellowships. Let's say he shuts down and he walks out of the room. Now, in an attempt to continue the conversation and to redeem yourself because he walked out on you, you follow him, pushing, prodding, poking until he explodes and probably slams the door in your face or yells some expletives at you or something like that, right? You get the gist. Mm-hmm. Guess what just happened beneath the surface? First, because you came to him discussing his poor money management skills, you triggered some of those vulnerabilities. Mm-hmm. Remember, what was the two that I said for men?
You said they were criticized and incompetent.
Yeah. So, and remember, you went to him talking about his poor money management skills. He began to feel both criticized and incompetent, right? He started to have to feel the need to protect himself.
Right.
That wasn't your intention. You weren't intending to make him feel incompetent or to make him feel criticized, right? But rather, it was a byproduct of his past baggage. Mm-hmm. So his past baggage mars his worldview of himself, causing him to have to kind of cope in certain areas, in certain ways. And that was his way. So because he felt threatened, he flees the situation. He left the room and in return, severed, guess what? The connection point that both of you guys had at the time. And in doing so, because he did this, you went into your own defense mode, which happened to be fight. So his defense mode is flight or flee. Yours is fight. So his way of coping was to flee the situation. Yours was to fight. Not like throwing fists and things like that, but it was to be a little bit aggressive, turn the knob up, raise your voice, get his attention, right? So when he flees, you fight, causing him to flee even more, which causes you to
fight even more.
Exactly. Fight even more. Now, this is an ugly but very common power struggle or loop,
cycle.
Or cycle, exactly, that most people find themselves in time in and time again.
And confused about why they keep getting there.
Yes. Like, why we keep arguing over the same thing? Well, it's because of the way we cope with the vulnerabilities that are triggered inside of us. But we're going to talk about that way later. But I just want you guys to be aware of that cycle, that loop, that power struggle that happens is so common in relationships. Now you may be wondering, okay, so how did we go from head over heels, in love, cloud nine, I will lick the ground that she walks on?
My
is that too much?
That's nasty.
It is kind of nasty, but some people feel like
I've heard drink her bath water.
Okay,
before.
That's That right there would just make me throw up.
I think I threw up
in my throat a little bit thinking about drinking somebody bath water, because that's where all of the extra stuff go that you're trying to get off your body.
But what's on the ground?
I mean, I don't know, but maybe your shoe cleaned.
We got off. Excuse us.
We got distracted. That was because that's nasty. Just drinking somebody bath water.
That's a common phrase.
Y'all go see me gag. But anyway, so you're probably wondering how we go from a beautiful love, lust-filled relationship to now all of a sudden we're in a cycle, right? Well, the answer is this. We fall in love with certain qualities, but over time, those same qualities begin to annoy us. Instead of seeing all of the ways that we fit, as we did in the first stage, because it was all about fitting together and complementing each other, now we see all of the ways that we're different. Mm. And on a deeper level, we begin to see our true selves reflected back to us when we look at our spouses. And this is hence the reason why I say this is the mirror stage, because when I look at Mandy, instead of seeing how beautiful and radiant she is, I start to see my own inadequacies. I start to see my own past wounds. But guess what? If I'm not self-aware, which is the vast majority of people, I'm going to blame Mandy for those feelings that I start to feel, right? Because when I look at her, I see my issues. That makes me feel vulnerable but not safe. So all of a sudden, I'm blaming Mandy for not making me feel safe enough to be vulnerable. Mm-hmm. This is deep. And if you can recall, baby, when we do our overflow, this is one of the main areas we talk about, right, mm-hmm. is helping to cultivate an environment of safety and security so that your spouse can be vulnerable. What are your thoughts about that?
I definitely agree, because I know that definitely when we were going through our tough time in our marriage, that's something I definitely had to learn. Because when you were pulling away during that season, you know, God helped me to realize what was going on inside of you. And he helped me to be patient and be still and quiet in certain moments that I wanted to lash out. Yeah. But because I allowed him to work on your heart instead of me trying to take over, then the atmosphere became one of peace and one of safety.
Yeah.
And so then you were able to open up and we were able to reconnect.
Well, and you know what? I like what you just said in terms of allowing God to work on me instead of you trying to work on me to get me to fit you.
Exactly.
Because that's very common, that most people get to this stage where they start to realize that the other person is not them. Mm-hmm. Like, I thought we were so much alike, and all of a sudden I'm looking at this person and they're not me. Mm-hmm. So something must be wrong with them because they're not me. Right. And all of a sudden the demands and the desires, right, they start to have contrasting points of views. And those contrasting points of views, those contrasting desires, contrasting demands. I like to, you know, put the toilet tissue over this way. You like to do it under. I like to put my wet towel on the bed. You like to not, right? Socks in the laundry versus socks on the floor. All those small things that used to be looked over are now points of contention. Mm-hmm. And I start to have doubts. Now we don't feel validated when we look at them. Instead, we get cognitive dissonance. Now we get doubts and we start to feel reluctant about the relationship. Mm-hmm. This reluctant theme is very common to what I talk about in my book,
right?
But it's really true. And this leads us up to the third stage of marriage. But for the sake of time, we're not going to cover that today. Mm-hmm. But I do want to just say, like, think about this, guys, as we're talking about the stages of marriage, the second stage of marriage. Are you there? Is your marriage in this stage? And it doesn't necessarily have to mean just because we said 3 years that you guys have been married 17 and you're still not in the stage. You could be stuck in the stage for a long time.
Or you could go back to that stage.
Exactly. Because I want you to think of stage as a spiral down, not a circle that has a beginning, middle, and end, but a spiral. Meaning you could spiral up or spiral down, but you can always return back to a stage.
Exactly.
In this stage, this is one of the most important stages to be aware of. Because if you're not aware of the man in the mirror or the woman in the mirror and you get caught up in blaming your spouse because of your own inadequacies, mm-hmm. then all of a sudden you're going to create a lot more forest fires.
Right.
Huge.
And then also realizing that, and I know that Dr. Gary Chapman has the book, The Four Seasons of Marriage. Mm. Sometimes you have one spouse that feels like they're in a particular stage and the other spouse would feel like they're in a different stage. And that could be the case over a number of years. I've heard that from several of the people that we work with. Yeah. that they thought everything was fine. Yeah. And then their spouse explodes and says, I've been feeling like this for the last 4 or 5 years.
And that's like, amazing. What? Think about that. How does that even happen?
Lack of communication,
a lack of being aware of the other person.
Yeah.
Remember we talk about being a student of your spouse?
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm not studying their body language.
And if we don't make it a habit to sit down with each other on a regular basis and ask questions, create a safe environment for each other to be able to share, you know, not making anything forbidden.
Yeah.
You know, because I've heard people say more than once, I wish my spouse would tell me X, Y, and Z. I wish they would come at me like this. Well, guess what? They probably never will. And then hopefully this doesn't happen, you know, but then that's what breeds, you know, these secret porn addictions and, you know, these what you know, what people do on social media, whatever they do, you know, behind closed doors that you don't know about that comes out years later.
Yeah. That's why it's so important to recognize the attributes of the mirror stage.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you are blaming your spouse for the person that you see when you look in the mirror, then you're doing it wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so, but here's the key. We're going to get to that in a minute as we talk about some of the later stages. So the next episode, episode number 49, we're going to cover two more stages. In this episode, we covered stages 1 and 2.
Mm-hmm.
In the next episode, we're going to cover stages 3 and 4. And this gets good. It gets even juicier because this is how you get to really make sure that your marriage is growing and thriving. See, your marriage can do either one or two things. It can thrive or dive.
Right.
You don't want your marriage to dive. You want it to thrive. But in any case, guys, we're going to wrap it up. Ooh, that rhyme. Thrive, dive,
it
dies.
Did.
It's like how it's my rap.
Oh, I didn't hear the guys.
You didn't hear the guys?
No,
I was trying
to
get my
good job,
on.
Baby.
But in any way, guys, we definitely appreciate your time. We're going to wrap the show up here, but be on the lookout for episode number 49, part 2 of this series. We're dropping some knowledge bombs. Hey, matter of fact, go to mendourmarriage.com/episode48 to listen to this, but to also leave your comments because we want to know what questions you guys have, right? We want to know what if you have any comments or concerns about what we talked about.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead and subscribe to this podcast in iTunes. Mm-hmm. Share this. We get a lot of shares on Facebook because of the content. Make sure that you're helping, you're doing your part to change marriages by sharing this with someone who you believe needs it.
Right.
So go to iTunes, subscribe to this podcast. All you got to do is find Mastering Marriage Podcast in iTunes and you can subscribe. You can also leave us an honest rating and review there. We'll love you for life. Anything else before we wrap up? Are we done? We ready to go out?
I think we're all good. I just want you all just to take all this stuff to heart, man, and really study it and really examine yourself. Because that's what I had to do, you know, at one point. And David had to do as well. We had to examine ourselves and be able to be honest with where we were so that we could grow past, you know, the difficult stage and start growing together as a couple, as a team.
Yeah. So, guys, we love you. We want to see you guys come down to Florida. Come visit us. Mastering Marriage Intensives happening, going down, overflow, popping. Yeah. The books. Oh, we got a new book coming out, baby.
We do.
A joint book.
Me and You.
It was not called Me and You, but it's going down. But anyway, let me stop. I don't want to get off the episode yet, but we'll see y'all in a couple of weeks on the next show, okay? How about we just do that?
Yep.
Episode number 49 coming soon.
Next time.
We out, y'all.
Deuces.
Deuces, baby.